Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Andrew Thompson, and welcome to the Rooted Right Ministries YouTube page. My wife, Christine, and I were obedient and blessed to start Rooted Right Ministries out of our home in October of 2021. I pray that these messages will be life-changing to you and help guide you into a deeper relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If these messages are making an impact on your life, please hit the subscribe button. But more importantly, pass on our YouTube page to family members and friends as we continue to spread the gospel. God has big plans for all of us. Also, if you feel led to come alongside us and support the ministry of Rooted Right, please go to our website, rootedright.org, and hit the give button. We are sacrificially giving and corporately believing for God to open up a permanent space for us to hold our church services and for us to more adequately meet the ministry needs of the Sun Prairie community and surrounding areas. We are honored that you took time to listen today and pray that you will join us soon for a church service at our current temporary location at the Prairie Athletic Club in Sun Prairie, Wisconsin. Luke 12:48 says, "To whom much is given, much will be required." Be blessed and accountable. Enjoy the message. Hallelujah. Happy Resurrection Sunday, everybody. It's great to see everybody's faces here. And thank you so much for all the newcomers that have come to be with us today. To celebrate, I got a word for you today. I've been spending time in the Word all week and excited about what God's going to do in your life today. And on Resurrection Sunday, the message title is this: God is not finished, but it is finished. For Christians, today is an absolute day of celebration. It's a joyous occasion that we get to remember what our Lord and Savior did for us on the cross. By the way, Jim did an amazing job on this cross, and I'm so thankful when people step up and use their gifts and talents. We didn't even ask for that, and somehow by Tuesday morning, he was getting at it after last week, and so amazing job. And then Kenan built a stand yesterday, watching him just slice through and measure and going out of his belt. Like, it was just amazing. I was so jealous. I've seen my dad do some amazing building himself, and so it's fun when people know what they're doing. And I said, all I have gift in there is you can just tell me what to do, and that's it. But he whipped that stand up in no time, and everybody last night that came and put the banquet room together did an amazing job. So thank you so much. I know I'm going to get in trouble when you start thanking people. My dad has always told me that too. Be careful when you start thanking people because you're always going to miss someone. So I thought I'd start when we're small. That way, when we get bigger, we can say a blanket thank you. But so many people have joined already and are giving their gifts and talents to Rooted Right Ministries, and we're so thankful for that. I know my wife didn't let you sit down when you were going through the offering, so you may have gotten tired standing up the whole time, but I do believe the word is holy, and I'm going to let you sit right after that. But if you wouldn't mind standing, only if you can, if you wouldn't mind standing for the reading of the word, and we'll get into this message today. For those of you that have your Bibles along or look on your phone, it's Matthew 28, it's going to be 1 through 6. Matthew 28, 1 through 6. Jesus is risen. Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. The guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. Just as he said, come see the place where he is lying." Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We celebrate the empty tomb. Christ is risen from the dead. Why does the resurrection even matter? It matters because it addresses our deepest problem. A problem that's not very popular to talk about in today's society. Every one of us has sinned against the Holy God. And because we serve a God that is holy and just, and because he is just, he must punish sin. But God is not only just, he is also loving. And because our sin separates us from him, he loved us so much that he sent his son in the flesh. Not as a conquering king like everybody thought would come, but as a suffering servant. And Jesus, the Son of God, gave his life for us on the cross. And then 3 days later, the resurrection, the stone was rolled away, and Jesus was raised from the dead. The resurrection is physical evidence that Jesus Christ paid the price for our sin, satisfying God's justice and displaying his amazing grace and unquenchable love while defeating death, hell, and the grave. Death, the wages of our sin, is death, both physical and spiritual. Hell, he took all of our sin and took it to hell where it belongs. And then the grave, our sin can send us to eternal death or what Jesus offers us in eternal life. But before we get to the celebrating part, and I know everybody likes that part, let's get the party started, right? We have to remember or remind ourselves or maybe even learn for the very first time what it is we are actually celebrating. Some of you in here may even feel like you're crashing the party. People next to you seem joyous, full of life, happy, in a celebratory mood, thankful. We heard those amazing songs that we sang, and those words may have rang hollow in our heart, even though it may have stirred some emotion and made us start thinking. Some of you, the way you're feeling inside says, I'm not feeling in a celebratory mood at all. In fact, if you knew what I was feeling inside and knew what was going on in my life, I'm not sure you'd feel like celebrating either. And so we got to backtrack a little bit and get a clear picture of why we gather here today to celebrate. The cross of Jesus Christ is the most precious emblem to those who call Jesus their Lord and Savior. We love the cross. We cherish it. Because of the price that was paid over 2,000 years ago when Jesus died for our sins. And the cross represents our forgiveness, our freedom, and our redemption. We love it so much that we adorn it in our churches, our homes. We make jewelry out of it. We wear clothes that have crosses on it. We make the cross look pretty. And we have watered down the message and what happened before he was taken to the cross and what he did on the cross. So before we get to celebrating, we want to reflect on what truly happened on Good Friday. We don't want to skip to the celebration and forget the blessings that come for what he did for us. When the pure Lamb of God hung on the cross that we deem so precious, he was naked. He was beaten. He was bleeding profusely. Before a watching world, it was a ghastly sight. It was the most horrendous moment in human history. Jesus' blood-drenched torso pouring from his head and his brow, running like rivers from the deeply torn flesh in his hands and his feet. Nobody wants to think about that. The effect of the scourging that Jesus had received began to take a toll as his body swelled up and became horribly discolored. His eyes were matted with blood that poured from the wounds in his brow, wounds caused by the crown of thorns that bore down into his skull as the soldiers pushed it hard upon his head. The whole scene was ugly, unsightly, repulsive, sickening, vile, foul, and revolting. I couldn't even think of any more adjectives. In fact, we had some of our closest friends that have joined us from the beginning from Rooted Right Ministries come over and watch the Passion on Friday for Good Friday service. And I had happened to watch it in the afternoon before we all watched it together that night for service. And I guess I had forgotten what Jesus had done for me. And so I watched as these soldiers beat him, whipped him, spit on him, laughed at him, mocked him, persecuted him. And as tears were running down my eyes, and I was so angry as I was watching this unfold in front of me, I really was angry inside. I said, how could these Roman soldiers do this to him? How could these religious leaders say the things that they were saying? How could the people that hailed him just 5 days earlier as he rode his donkey into Jerusalem, and they were hailing him as king, were now 5 days later saying, crucify him? I couldn't believe my eyes as I watched what they did to my Lord and Savior. And as I sat there with tears rolling down and trying to deal with my emotions, the Spirit of the Lord impressed upon my heart, you're one of the people that did that to him. Yes, Andrew, you whipped him. You made fun of him. You mocked him. You beat him over and over and over again with the decisions and the sins that you've committed in your life. I just wanted it to end. If anybody's ever seen The Passion, it just keeps going. And I know later on that night, as I was sitting there with the rest of the group, I knew how long it was going to take. And I could feel the passion, the emotion that was going on. And I could feel everybody almost saying in their minds, could it just be over with? And then it even hit me while I was watching it again. The reason why it took so long and it was so gruesome was that he had to take on all of the sins of the world, not just mine. And he did that for each and every one of us, not just me. And I was so thankful when it was finally done so we could try and move on. And that's usually what we try and do. And we get to the point where we're in Sunday. We had to experience Friday, and I think it's good for us to experience, just like I see right now, maybe some somber faces, maybe thinking of some things and decisions that we've made throughout our lives that we're not proud of, that we're sorry about, that we feel guilt and shame about. Well, I got some good gospel news today. When Jesus was on the cross and he was approaching death, he delivered to us what is known as his seven last words, his seven famous sayings or seven statements. But today we're going to focus on the sixth statement, the statement that he made right before his final statement, which was, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. But his sixth statement was this, in John 19 and 30. It is finished. It is finished. Three words in English, but in the Greek, we're all going to learn some Greek today. We're going to be like the cool kids. In the Greek, the word is tetelestai. Everybody say that with me. Tetelestai. Tetelestai. Yeah. See, that wasn't too hard. You know some Greek. And I want you to choose today as we go through this message. There's going to be some people that stand on this message today and are going to declare some things are finished in their lives. And you can choose whether you want to use tetelestai or it is finished. When you use the expression tetelestai, it was used to symbolize a great achievement, a victoriously completed mission. This was no small task. This was no minor victory. This was something you had to put blood, sweat, and tears in, time and energy, something you had to be committed to. You're grinding away. There's a process. You're believing you can get there, and you're not giving up. As an athlete, that was easy for me to think of. I could relate to something that was a great accomplishment, something that maybe you've been training for years, or that whole season you had a goal of winning a championship. Maybe we've all seen a Super Bowl victory or a World Series on TV or somebody winning a national championship, and you all have things in your own life that you were striving for, that you had to work hard for, that took some time and effort. And it wasn't easy. I could see, just like in the Super Bowl, when you see 100 grown men with huge muscles all going around crying and hugging. You know that what it took to get there, at least I do, because I was part of that world. And I could see them saying something like, "It is finished. We completed our goal. We completed our mission." That would be tetelestai. Let's take a look at the significance of those words, "It is finished," or tetelestai, and see what that means for us, for me and you, on Resurrection Sunday. Let's see what all this celebrating is all about. The first question we have to ask ourselves is, what was finished? This was Jesus' exclamation that he had finished the work the Father had sent him to do. The work having been fully completed, Jesus bowed his head and died. Tetelestai, meaning I have done exactly what you have requested. The mission is now accomplished. In that moment, Jesus cried out. He was exclaiming to the entire universe that he had faithfully fulfilled the Father's will and that the mission was now accomplished. No wonder Jesus shouted. This was the greatest victory in the history of the human race. How about that? The greatest victory in the history of the human race. You see how we just say words? He did the greatest victory in the history of the human race for you. Wow. That brings on a whole new meaning. We watch people do great things. We even cheer them on. But have you ever had somebody do all of that for you specifically? He had been faithful to his assignment, even in the face of unfathomable challenges. But now the fight was over, and Jesus could cry out to the Father, "I have done exactly what you asked me to do. The mission is accomplished." The second thing the word tetelestai represented was the equivalent, this is going to be some boring Old Testament stuff, but it's the fulfillment of prophecy. So Jesus is helping out the doubters. Tetelestai was the equivalent of the Hebrew word spoken by the high priest when he presented a sacrificial lamb without spot or blemish. In the Old Testament, we read about the high priest annually entering the Holy of Holies, where he poured out the blood of sacrificial spotless lamb on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant. The moment that blood touched the mercy seat, atonement was made for the people's sins for one more year. This was done year after year to obtain the annual temporary forgiveness of sin. But when Jesus hung on the cross, he was both lamb and high priest. In that holy moment, in that holy place, as great as our high priest, Jesus offered his own blood for the permanent removal of sin and offered a sacrifice so complete that God never again required the blood of lambs for forgiveness. This is why he is also called, he has many names, but he's also called the sacrificial Lamb of God. In Hebrews 9 and 12, it says this, "Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us." Thus, when Jesus said, "It is finished," atonement was completed, perfected, and fully accomplished. It was done once and for all, finished forever. The next question we have to ask ourselves is, what is it that Jesus' blood was used to pay for? In the secular sense, the word tetelestai was used in the business world to signify the full payment of a debt. Many of us can understand what that means. We've been in debt before. We haven't been able to make those payments. We feel that pressure starting to mount on us, and we maybe make some even more bad decisions to try and make that first bad decision work out. But when a debt had been fully paid off, the paper on which the debt was recorded was stamped with tetelestai, which meant the debt had been paid in full. This means that once a person calls Jesus the Lord and Savior of his life and personally accepts his sacrifice, No debt of sin exists for that person any longer. Hallelujah. The debt is wiped out because Jesus paid the price for that sin that no sinner could ever pay. We owe a debt that we could never pay. Jesus took our place. He paid the debt of sin we owed both physically and spiritually. And when we by faith repent and receive him as Lord, we're set free. This is why Paul wrote in Colossians 1, 13 and 14. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, even the forgiveness of sins. I feel somebody just feeling that wash away of those sins, even right now. When Jesus uttered those words, "It is finished," it was his declaration that the debt was fully satisfied, fulfilled, complete, and paid for. Jesus takes 33 years of his perfect life. Man, I wish I could just get one day. I'm trying every day right now. One day of perfection. But like I told some people that were able to come to Rooted Right Ministries a couple weeks ago, you made a perfect decision by coming to church today. So you're off to a really good start today. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. You see, God demands perfection. That's why we need Jesus, because we are not perfect. So Jesus fills that gap. I had a friend of mine say to me one time, why would anybody want to serve somebody that you are constantly failing? Why would you want to constantly live in a state of failure? And I thought, wow, completely missing the message of the gospel. Unless you honestly think that you don't need God and that you're perfect, which I'm almost positive that nobody in this room would say, then it's exactly what he did for us, to show us that we're not perfect and to thank him that he's the one that fills the gap between our imperfections and his perfect example. In fact, the Bible says that even our righteousness, even our good deeds, are as filthy rags in the Lord's eyes. Ouch, that hurts. I thought I was doing some good things, Lord. I thought I was serving you. I thought I was out there trying to change lives. I was volunteering, testifying on your behalf. Just as filthy rags. That's why Jesus had to be perfect. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. I'm going to read that again. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. Not one person can say, look at me. Look at what I've done. There are no good works you can do, no measure you can take that would make you better in God's eyes than anybody else sitting in this room. We're all at different points of our faith walk. That is true. But we all fall short of the mark of the high calling. I was listening to some messages this week, and I just like the example. Maybe it'll help some of us that feel like we're way behind in our faith journey. It was like all of us going to California, and we're on the beach, and somebody has the brilliant idea that says, hey, we're going to swim, all of us. We're all going to swim to Hawaii. That sounds like a great idea. So we all jump in, and since I'm married to a triathlete, Iron Woman, I'm imagining that I'm not going to make it quite as far as my wife does on our trip to Hawaii. But she's not going to make it there either. And so you see that even though you view some others that are further along, that know more of the word, that are living better than you, and you've done too much, you've gone too far, I don't know if I can go back. I don't know if I'm worthy. We all are going to fall short of that target. And we're all going to need Jesus to make up the gap. In classical Greek times, the word tetelestai also depicted a turning point. When one period ended and another period began. It's the cross that was the great divide in human history. It was the turning point. When Jesus cried out, "It is finished," he was shouting that the old covenant had ended and the new covenant had begun. In that divine moment, all of the Old Testament prophecies about Jesus' earthly ministry were fulfilled, and the New Testament began, which is where we find ourselves living today. I love that tetelestai depicted a turning point. It reminds me of true repentance and what the Lord offers us when he says, "It is finished." See, we have the choice. To repent literally means turn from sin. Meaning we were walking one way. This is literally what it means to repent. I'm walking towards the things of the world. I stop and I turn back and I start walking toward the things of Christ. It always amazes me when I read in scriptures about Jesus asking his would-be disciples. And I encourage you, if you don't know Jesus or anything about Jesus, it's hard to make this be more than just a story, something that sounds good, unless you truly get to know him. Those are those red words in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And so that's what I'm talking about when his would-be disciples, he just comes and he asks them to stop what they're doing. They're seemingly right in the middle of a normal day, a normal business day, and going about their business, running their business, doing their jobs. And for whatever reason, right in the middle, he just says, "Follow me." Could you imagine? I mean, put yourself in those shoes. You got your plans. You got your goals for life. You're grinding away. You're doing your thing. Little by little, you're getting closer and closer to your goal. And you're sitting at your desk or you're in the middle of working, building something. And all of a sudden, Jesus, the truth, just looks at you and says, "Follow me." And you just drop everything. And life has completely changed. An invitation to drop everything they knew that was so familiar to them and to start to follow Jesus. There must have been a momentary realization of the truth standing right in front of them. And here's the other one that hit me, an emptiness in our heart, yearning to be filled. I'll never forget those days, and those of you that have come in the past may have heard a smidgen of my testimony, but I'll never forget looking in the mirror after making it in the big leagues. Staying in the Sky Dome, being player of the game, being interviewed on the Jumbotron, watching myself in the hotel room on ESPN, thinking that it should be like a day like today. A glorious tetelestai day. It should be a celebration time. I should be feeling fulfilled. And I walked around that corner into the bathroom of that hotel room, and it was the scariest moment of my life. Knowing that I've been grinding away day after day after day, putting pressure on myself to achieve, trying to get to a place that I thought would fulfill me, and I realized at that moment, I was missing something. One of my newest friends in Christ just told me that one day, and very recently, he just said, "I realized, what have I been doing for the last 10 years? And boy, could I relate. When God got a hold of me in that moment of choice, that says, "For here on out, I'm ready to accept what Jesus did for me and receive his gift and be compelled to follow him." That moment happened to me at 7:38 p.m. on August 17th, 2020, on a golf course. when I received a call from a friend I hadn't talked to in 13 years. But God had prompted him to call me, and some 500 and some days later, after we'd been talking, reading the Word of God to each other, and praying over each other, I have a completely renewed mind and restored life. Because of what Jesus did on the cross. God is not finished with you, but it is finished. So what does tetelestai, or it is finished, mean for you? What does it mean today? Why are we here? It is finished is an opportunity for a new start. It is finished is a gift from Jesus to wipe the slate clean and get another chance. It is finished is an option to leave your old life behind and walk in a new life in Christ, like you will see today as 8 believers will get baptized. It is finished means it's time to stop thinking your old way and renew your mind daily in Christ. It is finished is a declaration for you, telling you that you don't have to live like you've been living anymore. Remember, Jesus stamped a paid in full stamp on your past sinful record, because Jesus paid the price for our redemption with his own blood. In Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, it says, "Surely he hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." So remember, if you're consumed with grief today, remember that Jesus bore your grief, and it is finished. If you're overwhelmed with sorrow, remember that he carried your sorrow to the cross, and it is finished. If you are trapped in a life of transgression, remember that he was wounded for your transgressions, and it is finished. If you are living in sin, you can be forgiven because he was bruised for your iniquities, and it is finished. If you are tormented and have no peace, remember that he was chastised for your peace, and it is finished. If you are physically or mentally sick, remember that he was wounded for your healing, and it is finished. Because of those 3 words and what he did for us on the cross, we have access to all of those promises and all of those blessings. But it takes one big decision on your part. You play a role in walking in the fullness of God for your life. And that role is for you to surrender your heart. Let Jesus take over. Make him the Lord and Savior of your life. There's only room for one person on the throne of your heart. And it was made, you were made, to give it back to our Lord and Savior. And that's why we gather today, to celebrate all that he's done. I know it's hard to listen to and to think about, and for those that were with us on Friday night, it's going to be hard to get those memories out of what Jesus did for us. I know there wasn't hardly a dry eye in the place. It's difficult to watch, but that's Friday's pain has brought Sunday's celebration. We don't serve a God who is dead. We serve a living God. And he has rose for us, and we have access to everything that we just talked about when he said, "It is finished." Luke, would you start playing some music for me, please? We're going to have a couple worship songs to end the service today. I'm going to give you a chance today to thank Jesus for what he did for you and what he did for me and what he did for all of us and to make him the Lord of your life. We're going to stay seated while we enjoy this time of worship. There's going to be three things that'll happen during worship time here. For some of you, it'll just be a reflection time. For others of you, it's going to be a commitment time. And as we go to prayer, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, we thank you for what you've done for us. Lord, we gather today to celebrate you. We honor you for what you've done. Lord, it's a gift for us. Individually, a gift for us corporately. We thank you for what you're doing in us and through us today and every day going forward. Lord, there's some in this room that as they heard that message, maybe learned about what you did for us for the very first time or had heard in the past and it hit them differently today. Lord, we're asking for you to show up right now. This first prayer that we're going to pray, and we'll do it corporately as all heads are bowed and all eyes are closed. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, and you would like to give your heart and your life to him now, would you please just raise your hand up slowly? Just raise your hand up slowly if God's laying on your heart. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. If you raised your hand up, we're going to say the sinner's prayer together with you. And I'm just going to have you repeat, and we're all going to repeat it together. Lord, if you'd repeat after me. Lord, I admit I am a sinner. I need and want your forgiveness. I accept your death as the penalty for my sin. And I recognize that your mercy and grace is a gift. That you had offered to me because of your great love. But not based on anything I have done. Cleanse me and make me your child. By faith, I receive you into my heart as the Son of God and as the Savior and Lord of my life. From now on, help me live for you with you in control. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you would keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed, the second prayer that we're going to pray will be for all of those that feel like there was something that was offered to you by our Lord and Savior today as you listen to what It Is Finished was all about. There's something in your life that you are ready to give over to Jesus and declare, "It is finished." If that was you during that time, if you would just raise your hand slowly. Thank you. Thank you. And I'm just going to pray a prayer as we all reflect during this last worship song. If you raised your hand and are ready to say that it is finished in some area of your life, Father, we just lift that up to you right now. Lord, I thank you for your presence in this room. I thank you that you're ministering to us. Thank you for what we've learned that you've done for us and the access that we have to your gift. Thank you that we can walk in the fullness and the promises of God. Thank you the access that we have to have relationship with you each and every day. Lord, we know that we can be led by you, led by your Spirit. But Father, we have to surrender our heart, and we do that. Lord, we know you as our Lord and Savior, but there's some areas of our lives that we've been holding back, that we've been trying to control, that we haven't truly surrendered over to you. And Father, as we do that, I pray that we would feel great victory. Lord, surround us with people, like-minded people, that can help us learn the Word of God and be accountable to you and to your Word. Surround us with great fellowship of fellow believers. And Lord, help us use all of our gifts and talents to glorify you. We come together and we call this done, and we thank you in advance for what you're going to do in our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen.